grateful for the opportunity, Father, but a lot of people are wondering, what are we doing? What is this all about? Why are we here?
Well, I just want to say, you know, thank you to begin for being here this holy hour. Se me hizo muy bonito, de veras, ver tantas personas de la comunidad en esta hora santa. Fue un sentido de comunidad y de unidad entre nosotros. So the sense of coming together, I think it's really encouraging for me. And I think it's part of the result of us working out our mission statement of welcoming all God's children. But there's a second part that we've been working on. Not only do we want to welcome all God's children, but we want to make them disciples. And so esa es una realidad de nuestra misión que la estamos viviendo. Que hace años empezamos a trabajar en darle la bienvenida a todo el mundo, pero después de un proceso de discernimiento, el Señor nos llamó a empezar a crear discípulos. Entonces parte de ese proceso de crear discípulos. Hace algunos meses, o hace más de un año, estudiamos un libro de cómo formar discípulos intencionalmente, y eso participamos en el encuentro, en el quinto encuentro, en el proceso de formar discípulos misioneros. Entonces, esos dos intentos para formar discípulos aquí en San José, y esa es la tercera oportunidad que tenemos para aprender cómo formarnos y cómo formar a otras personas como discípulos. Entonces, this is part of fulfilling our mission. As you remember, some, you know, over a year ago, we studied a book called Forming Intentional Disciples. And after we studied that book, we had a retreat for the entire parish. And then after that, some of us participated in the fifth national encuentro process in learning how to form missionary disciples. And so this is our third opportunity we have as a parish community to form ourselves, because that's an ongoing process in our lives, to form ourselves as disciples of Christ, but to also learn how to form others as disciples.
So wonderful. So you're talking about discipleship. What defines us as disciples of Christ? What does that mean exactly?
If we look at the Catechism of the Catholic Church, for those of you who would like to reference it, it's paragraph 1816, 1860. It clearly defines disciples as a person who follows Christ, who not only keeps the faith, but lives the faith, professes the faith, and then confidently bears witness to it, and then begins to spread. Okay? So the Catechism invites us to live the faith, not just talk about it and know it, but to live it, and then to be good witnesses of our following Christ, and then to learn how to spread the good news, how to evangelize others. Entonces el Catecismo de Iglesia Católica, el párrafo 1816, nos dice que el discípulo es uno el que vive la fe. No nomás la proclama, sino vive la fe, tiene una manera de profesar la fe que da testimonio de lo que cree, pero también reta a la persona a compartir esa fe con los demás. O sea, ser evangelizadores, tratar de que los otros puedan creer y profesar la misma fe que nosotros creemos y profesamos. Y eso es bien importante para la iglesia hoy en día. No simple ser católicos externamente, pero católicos de corazón. You know, so we need to be, you know, conscious and called to be, you know, disciples of Christ that comes from the heart and not just from the head, understanding our faith, but really learning to live it and share it with others.
Nice. So when I think of discipleship, we all heard it in the scripture of Matthew, right? Go out and make disciples of all nations. We all have heard that over and over again. What does it mean? How are we called to make disciples? How do you make disciples?
Well, you know, I think this is one of my favorite scriptures. And I have tried to live by this scripture for a long time. And I'm still learning. After many years of being a priest, I'm still learning what it means to make disciples. But what strikes me, it says that you go and make. You don't go and discover them, or you don't wait for them to come to you. It actually takes movement from us that we have to go out and proclaim the good news and then make them. Now that making them is kind of hard. You know, I know how to bake cakes. You have there's the recipe.
Good, because I know.
Yeah. I can cook almost anything with a recipe. You know, so for years I've been looking, okay, I want a recipe of how to make disciples when I found one.
Oh.
And what I found is I begin to understand, you know, through other people who are forming other disciples, that if we understand, you know, what a disciple looks like, you know, if we can identify the characteristics of a disciple, then we can begin to learn how to make them. Entonces, para aprender cómo ser discípulos, ojalá podamos estar motivados con ese evangelio de Jesús que nos envía a ser discípulos, dice. Vayan y hagan discípulos en Mateo 28, 19. El cómo hacer los discípulos es el reto. Y después de muchos años de sacerdote, apenas siento yo que estoy descubriendo de cómo hacer discípulos. Y descubrí, escuchando a otras personas que han vivido esa experiencia de formar discípulos, que hay 6 características. Y las voy a nombrar ahorita, pero no se preocupen, no vamos a hablar de las 6, no vamos a hablar de una. Y las 6 características, son, perdón, 5 características. La primera es creer en Jesús, es crecer en nuestra fe, es unirnos como comunidad cristiana, el amar a otros como Dios nos amó y guiar a otros a Cristo. Esas son las características. And so those 6 characteristics are that we believe in Jesus, we grow in our faith, we gather as a Christian community, we love as Jesus loved, and we lead others to Christ. So those are the 5 characteristics, but you don't have to worry, I'm not going to talk about all 5 tonight. We're going to focus on the first one, because it's a probably the most significant one. It is to believe. And to make disciples, you know, I'm absolutely convinced now, especially after being a priest 31 years, that it's got to begin with me. That me as a priest, as a pastor, I have to model what it means to be a disciple. That I have to profess my faith in Jesus in a way that's believable. It's not just me preaching or talking, it's a way that people who hear me and see me, you know, recognize that this is real in my life. So that's my way of saying to all of us that if we're gonna make disciples, it begins with ourselves. Entonces, si queremos hacer discípulos, tiene que empezar con nosotros mismos. No podemos empezar con el hermano, con el esposo, con el compadre. Empieza con nosotros. Y yo siento que a través de los años estoy más y más convencido que como párroco, como hacerlo, tengo que empezar conmigo mismo. A dar ese ejemplo, que es una persona que estoy en proceso, todavía estoy en ese camino, aprendiendo cómo ser un mejor discípulo. Entonces, esa es una manera de decir, no solo para mí, pero para todos. Si queremos hacer discípulos, empezamos con nosotros mismos.
So, I can't make my husband a disciple before me?
No.
Why?
No, well, it doesn't work that way.
But that's funner, Father, if he begins to be the disciple,
I know,
then
that's
I'll
a lot
follow.
Of fun, yeah. Okay. And I think we do that. We begin to look at the faults in other people.
Oh, all the time.
Yeah, and it's like, oh, they got to change this. They got to correct that. I mean, I don't know. I'm not married, but that's what I think husband and wives do. And maybe we as priests sometimes do that also. We want the parishioners to change.
Okay, so to begin, we first have to believe. Father, do you believe in the time and day that we're living in now? Do you believe? Yeah.
Well, I want to say, you know, first of all, that this kind of faith is something that you have to live. You have to believe in Jesus wholeheartedly, because you're not going to be able to give to others what you don't have.
Amen.
And I remember one of my favorite documents of the church is Evangelii Nuntiandi that was written by Pope Paul VI. And he said, and something that struck me years ago, the evangelizer continues to be evangelized. So I recognize in any effort that I'm, you know, putting into practice of forming disciples, I'm at the same time working with myself. That's very important. Entonces, es importante estar consciente de que yo me estoy formando al mismo tiempo que estoy formando a otros. En el documento Evangelii Nuntiandi, el Papa Pablo VI nos recordó de esa realidad. Entonces, tenemos que creer con todo nuestro corazón en Jesús y poder hablar de Jesús y hablar de esa fe viva, que a veces es difícil para otros católicos, no estamos acostumbrados a hablar así. Pero es algo que necesitamos empezar a practicar y hacer.
So, how did you come to believe, Father? Did you just wake up one day and say, I believe?
I wish it was that easy.
So how? What? How did you come to this belief?
Hay dos cosas que a mí me ayudó mucho para creer en Jesús. Y yo empecé, yo recuerdo de jovencito, de niño, empecé a caminar con el Señor, pero lo hacía porque mis papás lo estaban haciendo y mis abuelos. You know, so I knew Jesus, I knew about Jesus, because I saw mom and dad going to church and my grandparents, and I participated in a lot of things at church. And I think that was real significant for me. I had a positive experience with family, going to church and being active. Entonces siempre íbamos a misa, nunca fallábamos, y mis abuelos, ellos tengan en paz, mis papás los tengan en paz, especialmente, fue mucho muy activo. You know, mom was never real active, mi mamá no, pero siempre estaba presente. Pero todos los demás sí muy activos, y yo lo que empecé a notar en ellos, que ellos cambiaron de un día para otro. Yo vi un cambio en ellos y me entró una curiosidad. When I saw this change happening, I kept wondering what happened, you know, to my family. Because I knew it wasn't just going to church, it was really living a faith, living something. And it began to be focused on Friday nights, not just Sunday, but Friday nights we would gather as a community for a holy hour. And then we'd have mass, and then we had a holy hour, and then we would pray with arms, all the men would cross their arms like this to pray. And it really began to speak to me that there was something there. And so that really struck me. Entonces yo empecé a ver ese ejemplo de mis papás que se acercaban al Santísimo a orar, a mis abuelos, toda la comunidad los viernes, y rezaban con los brazos así en cruz. Entonces me llamó la atención. Entonces eso fue algo muy positivo. Al mismo tiempo, yo sufrí mucho, porque yo viví en un hogar muy disfuncional. Entonces, en la iglesia éramos una familia, pero en la casa éramos totalmente diferente. En la casa había muchos gritos, había mucho conflicto entre mis papás, mi hermano adicto, Dios lo tenga en paz, adicto a las drogas, al alcohol, había infidelidad. Había muchas cosas que yo, ¿cómo puede ser que vamos a la iglesia, en la casa, no estamos viviendo esto? So that was just a very painful thing. You know, I just couldn't make sense of my life as a, you know, maybe a 10, 11 year old, how could we be so active at church and I could see, you know, Jesus alive in my mom and dad, at the same time they'd be screaming and yelling at each other at home. And there was so much conflict, and there was a brother addicted to drugs and alcohol and all the screaming and yelling. That was very painful, and I began to search.
Which is common in homes.
And even more so now, it seems like. But you know, the other thing was my personality. You know, believe it or not, and people always laugh at me, they don't think it's true, but I'm a very introverted person. And I was very shy. And very withdrawn from everything and everyone. And so I began to feel very lonely. And that was my way of handling it. Yo me empecé a distanciar de la familia. Me sentía solo. No tenía, como que no podía hacer amigos. Porque yo estaba bien confundido. Entonces yo buscaba mi identidad como hijo de Dios, como parte de la familia. Pero todo esto me ayudaron dos cosas. Two things were very helpful to me. And one, believe it or not, was a song. And some of you have heard of Kris Kristofferson. Yeah, he's kind of a country singer.
Of us that are a little younger.
Yeah, a lot of people, Spanish speaking, don't know Kris Kristofferson. But he's saying a song called Why Me, Lord. Mm. And
that's a good one.
When I can sing that song today, I know the words and I cry with those words. Because that was me coming to Jesus as, why me, Lord? You know, what have I ever done, you know, to deserve, you know, all you've given me? And what can I do? So eso empezó a ser un canto para mí. ¿Por qué yo, Jesús? Yo que no me merezco nada. ¿Por qué haces tanto por mí? ¿Qué puedo hacer yo por ti? Entonces empecé a tener ese encuentro con Jesús por medio de ese canto. Yo en las noches me acostaba llorando, escuchando ya las cosas que estaban pasando en la casa, en otro cuarto. Y yo me concentraba en ese canto, en esa canción. Y encontraba a Jesús en mi corazón y me calmaba para poder dormir. And so that was a very consoling experience for me to be able to, you know, embrace, you know, that love of Jesus through that song. But there was a second thing. And the second thing was scriptures from Jeremiah. Yeah, the first chapter of Jeremiah, you know, Jeremiah was a young prophet. And he's been sent out into the wolves, you know, and he's scared. He says, who am I? And Jesus says, you know, I will give you the words. I will touch your lips and give you my words. I have chosen you to be the prophet to the nations. And I started hearing Jesus say, that's you, Hector. Entonces esas palabras no eran nomás para Jeremías. No, yo las escuchaba como palabras para mí. En ese primer capítulo de Jeremías que decía, enviaba a Dios a Jeremías a ser profeta. Y él tenía miedo, decía, yo soy un joven, ¿yo quién soy? Y le dice, yo te he escogido como profeta para las naciones. ¿Y qué voy a decir? Yo tocaré tus labios y pondré mis palabras en tus labios. Y eso empezó a animarme a mí, empecé a sentir yo ese llamado. Ok, me estoy enamorando de Jesús y me está pidiendo algo, me está enviando a hacer algo. Y eso fue lo que me dio la fortaleza para poder seguir adelante. Entonces yo empecé a responder a esa relación íntima con Jesús. Entonces yo puedo decir que criándome no tenía muchos amigos, pero tenía el amigo más importante que podría tener uno, es Jesús. Y eso me abrió las puertas. Porque al encontrarme yo con Jesús, empecé a sentir más seguridad en mí mismo y empecé a ver a Jesús en los demás. Porque hubo otra cosa que me sucedió, que me hizo sufrir mucho. Que nosotros fuimos los primeros hispanos que nos fuimos a vivir en un barrio de no hispanos. Y sentí rechazo por primera vez. Entonces eso me abrió a mí los ojos, no solo encontrar a Jesús en mí, pero en los demás. A pesar de que me lastimaba, unos me odiaban, me apuntaban, me señalaban, me decían nombres, porque vivíamos en este barrio donde no pertenecíamos. Pero mi papá siempre decía, Dios está en ellos también. Y eso me ayudó a extenderme un poquito y a buscar a Dios en los demás. So the final thing, you know, that I say was very, you know, important to me was another very painful thing. As I began to discover Jesus and understand through Jeremiah that I was being called to this ministry, I didn't understand what that meant. That another experience that I had in our neighborhood caused me to come out of myself a bit. And what happened is that we were the first Hispanic Latino family that moved into a complete white neighborhood. You know, and I grew up with Dennis and Menes.
Yes.
And Dennis and Menes was like the perfect neighborhood in the world to me.
Were you Dennis?
Well, no, I wasn't. I was just an observer.
Mm-hmm.
I kept thinking, that's the whole world, that's city life, because we did that in the country before this. But, I thought, you know, in Dennis and Menes, they'd go to the neighbor,
yeah,
and they'd borrow a cup of sugar.
Yes.
And they would always give them the sugar.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that image spoke to me. It's like, you can go next door and get sugar. you go next door to go buy it.
Yeah.
But that's being a neighbor. So I assumed that when we moved into town, that's the way it was. The first time I ever went to say hi to somebody, one of our neighbors, they kicked me out.
Oh.
They said I didn't belong in the house, I didn't even belong in the neighborhood, because I wasn't white. And I went crying to Dad, and Dad said, God is in them as well. And I didn't understand it, and I was hurting, it was so painful. But having this encounter with Jesus in a very personal, individual way, I begin to say, okay, I got to believe that. And God is in them. So I begin to very intentionally seek God in others. But all that those painful experiences helped me, you know, get excited. By the time I graduated from high school, you know, I knew Jesus. Jesus knew me.
Yes.
And that song reminded me, you know how I've been. I know who I am. And you still call me. And I'm here to serve you. And I knew that I could trust just like Jeremiah. You know, Jeremiah trusted, and he was able to do many things, so I felt I can do the same thing. Entonces, para cuando terminé la escuela, la secundaria, entonces yo estaba bien animado y confiaba mucho, no solo en mi relación con Jesús, pero que Él me había escogido a mí. Entonces, yo sabía que todo lo que tenía que hacer es ponerme en las manos de Dios y Él iba a confiar en mí. Y me ayudó mucho la comunidad me apoyó mucho. Me empezó a animar a que me fuera al seminario, empezaron a orar por mí, empezaron a comprometerse, a acompañarme a través de los años. Y gracias a Dios lo hicieron. Y eso me ayudó a mí mucho. And so when I graduated from high school, you know, the whole parish community of St. Anthony's got behind me and they committed to praying for me and accompanying me, you know, through this process of becoming a priest. And they were there. They made a promise, for example, a group of men promised that they would pray for me the rosary every Friday night until I became a priest. Well, they waited 10 years. They prayed for me for 10 years to become a priest. Wow. And they had no idea that I wasn't even going to be in the Lubbock Diocese. I was going to come to Amarillo. So I get ordained and come to Amarillo. He says, what? You're supposed to come back home. I said, no, God's called me somewhere else.
So I think it's really beautiful to begin with the belief, right? Do I believe? And that's something that we can all walk away with tonight. Begin there, because that's the first step in becoming that disciple. Ask yourself, do I believe? Do I believe in the midst of even Father Hector's pain and experience? To go and experience God in the sanctuary, in the parish, in the community, with other families who profess this belief, but then to go home to a family who was torn, who was divided, who was dysfunctional, who had chaos. You know, I can relate. I mean, and I think all of us can relate to that, right? That's when we really cling to Christ and ask ourselves, do I believe only when things are good and beautiful and peaceful? Or do I believe beyond that, when there's anger and there's disruption and there's division and there's chaos? So it's beautiful that we begin there with making a disciple, because we have to answer that question ourselves. Do we believe? So.
And you know, I think that's where I'm now. Yes. You know, I just came back from vacation and I spent a lot of time by myself. I spent a lot of time resting. But it's been a very emotional, you know, last 2 or 3 weeks. Because what I found growing up at home, I'm finding in the church today. You know, with all the stuff that's going on in the church with our bishops and cardinals, and what's been going on for some time, you know, it's like, I'm confused again. You know, it's like, we're saying one thing and doing something else. And so I withdrew, and it wasn't just a vacation, it was like a retreat for me. Because I was able to look at myself and think, okay, I've been there. Mm-hmm. At a small scale.
Yeah.
But I've been there, and I think it's not by luck or by accident. Maybe it was intentional. God meant this to happen. Isn't it beautiful? It was my first full day at work. And what do? We gather as a community to pray before the Blessed Sacrament. And I would say that's what is I have to hold on to. That with all this dysfunction of the church, this dishonesty, this pain that we're causing each other, and all the failings, you know, I have to go back to where I started, you know, and really focus on Jesus in my life and continue to be strengthened by his presence in my life and recognize that I'm not here to judge. I'm here to pray for and accompany and help people. You know, whether they're the people that are causing the pain or people that are being hurt, that all of us are called to be there for one another, to be honest, to be truthful, to be willing to challenge, but to recognize that Jesus is there to guide us and to heal us. And I'm not going to lose hope, you know, in the midst of this. You know, it just tells me I need to look at myself.
Yes.
I really look at, where am I in my relationship with the Lord? Where am I in my calling to priesthood? And truly, you know, go through this process we were talking earlier of purification, that the church that the Lord has taken us through as a church. But I've got to allow that to happen in my own life.
Amen. And I have to allow that to happen in my own home, right? The purification and sanctification of the domestic church, which we all are a part of. And I thank God. I mean, I know it's hard to look at it for what it is, but there's a purification, there's a sanctification, there's a cleansing that's taking place, and we're all called to do the same. It's not just our priests. It takes place at home as well, and I think that's what's important to focus on. Remember, going back, do I believe? Now we ask ourselves, do I believe, regardless of what's happening out here, because of what's going on in our own homes? And unfortunately, we've worked with lots of families, like I told you earlier, marriage and families, and no family goes unscarred by that. No family. But yet we do the same. We stay in silence and we cover it up and we just don't talk about it. So I think what the church is doing now is showing us how we can be merciful to one another, and allow one another to come out and be freed from something that, you know, was horrifying. So, I mean, I think it's perfect that, look at how much love Father Hector has for his parish families. Continuously, never giving up, because he knows, he believes, he has that encounter every time he sees you and receives you. You know, and that's what we're called to be, right? That's making those disciples. It's in the midst of that everyday encounter. So I thank you for allowing me to be part of this.
Yeah, but I, you know, I'm very conscious of my own
sinfulness.
Sinfulness.
Me too, Father. Me too. Especially when you're part of the church, huh? Everybody's looking. It's like, okay.
Pero yo quiero compartir también eso en español, de que sí me siento triste. En cierta manera me siento avergonzado por lo que está pasando con nuestros líderes en la iglesia, pero al haber tomado este tiempo de vacaciones fue como un retiro para mí, para reencontrarme con el Señor, y veo yo algo muy similar a lo que está pasando en la iglesia, que me confunde, que me hace cuestionar, que me hace enojar, que de veras a veces siento odio. Y digo, ¿cómo puedo seguir yo aquí sirviendo a esta iglesia? ¿Cómo voy a obedecer a mis superiores? ¿Cómo voy a respetar yo a esas personas con tanta autoridad? Ahora que estamos descubriendo esas cosas. Pero siento yo, bueno, ya lo viví una vez. Y supe cómo superar eso. Entonces tengo que enfocarme en lo mismo. Y es en mi relación con el Señor. Y saber de que yo también soy pecador. De que yo también he fallado en muchas maneras. Usted me conoce, conoce mi personalidad y me siguen queriendo, llamando, y así también siento, yo tengo esa misma responsabilidad como discípulo de Cristo de perdonar, de confrontar, de hablar, como decía, la verdad, de no ocultar, de no mantener los secretos, sino de dar la oportunidad de sanar. Y es muy triste, como nos dice ella, porque yo estoy consciente que no son nomás los sacerdotes y los obispos y los cardenales. Hay papás, mamás, hay familias que están haciendo las mismas cosas en el hogar. Yo he escuchado, yo conozco familias que han acudido a la iglesia buscando esa sanación. Entonces, tenemos que ver, no es una excusa por la iglesia, porque estamos en la iglesia, pero reconocer que todos somos afectados de una manera u otra de lo que está sucediendo en la iglesia y en el mundo. Y podríamos aquí alegar quizás del por qué, no importa el por qué, el punto es que está sucediendo, y lo más importante es confiar en Dios, que va a poder sanarnos y guiarnos. Entonces, que ojalá que podamos abrir nuestros corazones para que la iglesia sea purificada por medio de este proceso, pero también nosotros, que seamos purificados como familias, que podamos purificar nuestros hogares, podamos purificar nuestras parroquias. Y empezando conmigo, podemos purificar mi propia vida.
Amen. So, Father, is there anything else that you want to share with your peeps out here about making disciples?
Well, I just want to again thank you for being here. I really appreciate, you know, you taking the time to come and just encourage you. You know, hopefully my sharing with you has helped you look into your own hearts. I invite you to look at your own hearts and look at where you are in your relationship with the Lord, where you've been. Look at those moments in which you have encountered Jesus. Where those moments and places where you know Jesus has been with you. And that you knew that he was there and he was there to love you. And continue to nurture that. And as you do that, you know, make a commitment to continue this process. To learn how to be a true disciple, because at the end, what we're called to do, as the Catechism calls us, is we're called to evangelize, to share this with others. And so I want to invite you to do that, is number one. And number two, come back next month.
Amen.
Come back next month, because we're between David and Lupita, we're going to be going through the other four steps or characteristics of discipleship. And I would encourage you, don't come by yourself. Go and share. Hopefully, if something moved you and touched you for tonight, share it with other people and make a commitment to bring others to this so that this group can continue to grow especially us as a parish community. Entonces quiero invitarlos a que tomen en cuenta su propia relación con Jesús. Ojalá que un poquito de mi testimonio les haya ayudado a ustedes a recordar sus encuentros con el Señor, de cómo empezaron y cómo siguen con el Señor. Y no pierdan la esperanza, sigan buscando a Dios en su hogar, aquí en la iglesia, en su comunidad. Entonces los invito a que le den gracias a Dios y tomen tiempo para reflexionar un poco en esa realidad. Pero les voy a pedir un segundo favor, y el segundo favor es que sigan este proceso. Ese es el primer paso de 5 pasos, y los invito a que regresen el mes que entra, donde David o Lupita van a compartir con nosotros los otros pasos. Pero es importante que regresen para que vayan formándose, y al regresar, quizás pueden, por medio de su testimonio, si comparten con otros lo que han vivido, lo que les gustó de hoy, inviten a otros y tráiganse una o dos personas más. So I would ask you to make the commitment to bring somebody with you. And I think I'd like to
remember what transformed his life and deepened his conversion was his faith family, because what he was going through at home didn't match up, didn't measure up to what he had faith in. So this right here, community, is crucial. So keep it up.
So growing up, this song, Why Me Lord, was my discipleship song, but I didn't know it, 60 years ago, but I do now. So we'll listen to this and finish. That way you know what I'm talking about.
What have I ever done to deserve even one of the pleasures I've known? Tell me, Lord, what did I ever do that was worth loving you for the kindness you've shown? Lord, help me, Jesus, I've wasted it. So help me, Jesus, I know what I am. But now that I know that I've needed you, so help me, Jesus, my soul's in. I can try to repay all I've taken from you. Maybe, Lord, I can show someone else what I've been through myself on my way back to you. Lord, wasted it, so help me, Jesus, I know what I am. But now that I know that I've needed you, so help me, Jesus, my soul's in. My soul's in your hand.